And here we present it with the IPython notebook. You'll see I'm using the Chrome browser here, and it starts off with a notebook there, and it's because I launched it while I was in my home directory, it's going to show that up. And this is just our normal folder structure on my computer. I'm going to go here to my desktop, and the healthcare research lectures there, and there is one file in there. It's an IPYNB, or IPython file, IPython notebook file, I should say. I can delete it there, which I don't want to do. If I click on it, it's going to open. Before I do that, though, I just want to show you this new notebook. So that is how we're going to create a new notebook. I think I'll repeat it later. Whenever you open a new notebook, that notebook's going to be saved on your hard drive in whichever folder you are in at the moment. So let's just click new folder there, or new notebook, and this is what it looks like. I'm going to run through that again in a minute. You can click on there to go to the website. There's the name. We'll run through that. This is our toolbar up here, and normal things that you would see there: file, edit, view, the normal things, and some other weird ones. And a save button again, insert cells, cut and copy and paste. We can see moving cells up and down, and then more importantly, the playing of the cells and the type of cells. We'll get to that again. And this is the beauty of IPython. So this is a cell. This is where you're going to type your code. At the moment, the cell that is active is set to code, but look, I can also set it to markdown. Markdown, there's a special shorthand sort of computer code that you can write text with, but you can also use normal HTML tags now in this, and it will render this code to this web page as if it is code written specifically for a web page. Some shortcuts there, heading one, heading two, remember from HTML, those would just be the size of the text. So in short, this is a notebook, but let's open the one that we really want to see. When I've left it open there, so it says I can shut it down. The other way to shut it down would be first to save it, and then to say file, close and halt. Now when I go there, it's not open anymore. We can delete it. There's the delete button. So let's open introduction to the IPython notebook. Now immediately you'll see that it has changed its look. It doesn't look like the other one, and that's because of this code. Now this code is going to run immediately. All these files look the same. It will say setting up a fancy style sheet. You can do some CSS files. So don't worry, that's not part of the course, but you can write some style sheets, cascading style sheets. You can import that, and that will render this web page looking a bit different. So this is the render I've gone for and the design that I've gone for just for this course. So don't worry about this few lines of code. What I do want to show you, if I go into that first cell and double click on it to edit it, you'll see it is markdown, and I can just type normal text in there. I didn't even use any HTML or markdown language. I just typed in that, and if I run that, it is just normal HTML output to this web page. Now in cell 2, we're going to run that. Don't worry about this code, but to execute it, I'm in that cell, and I just hit the play button, and it executes. Now you're going to see this numbering down here. The first time that you run it, you're not going to see these numbers, but it's going to start off always with number one. And when you hit enter and that code is busy executing, there'll be a little star there, and then it turns to whatever number cell is. These are really not important for us. The other thing that I'm always going to do at the top of these cells is just to set up my Python environment. This is going to start looking a lot more complicated, and we'll go through this for the moment. I'm just using this code. Ignore that for now. All I want to do is run it. Remember, here I press the play button. Here I'll do the other way of doing it. You hold down the shift key and then hit the return or enter key. And that will also play that cell. So look at this cell. it's nice and fancy and big text. If I double click on it, you'll see it is, the cell is marked as H1, heading 1. And my style sheet will render the type of text that I wanted there. So it's just a nice way to lay out your notebook. If you wanted to hand this notebook over to someone else with some text and coding in, this is a lovely way to do it. And that is why IPython is so fantastic for scientific computing, because you can really collaborate, send your notebooks to someone else. You can annotate it with normal text, intermix it with code. It's just fantastic. There's our citation there for Fernando Perez and the guys who developed IPython and still actively developing it. I think you can't say enough about this IPython and IPython notebook effort. It really is phenomenal what these guys have done and are doing. So this IPython, it's not only the notebook that we're dealing with here. If you use something like Anaconda to install your Python environment, specifically on the Windows and the Mac version, you're going to get a launcher that also has the other two parts of the IPython family. And number one is just going to be a terminal window called the Qt console. And that just looks like a normal command prompt window or terminal window. And you can write your IPython code there. And there's also the scientific development environment called Spider that is also installed. We're not going to use that. We make use of this notebook. Now you can learn a lot more. Just to show you this cell here, learning more, I just typed the letters and I marked it as heading 2. And when I execute it by holding in shift, hitting return or enter, it renders beautifully as H2 text. Now you can learn a lot more from the IPython website itself. Let's just see how I constructed the cell. P, the tags P there, that's normal HTML. That's just paragraph, close paragraph. You don't have to learn HTML code or markdown code, but you'll pick it up just by double clicking on the cells and you'll quickly learn the basics of it. HTML is really easy. And this is these two star signs here, which is shift 8 on most keyboards. That is just the shortcut for italics. So anything between two stars, and there's got to be no spaces there, will output just as italics. The other way to do it was just use HTML tags. That would be I. And remember, always do close your tags. Close I. So anything between those tags would be italicized. And the website, I just typed that normally. IPython changed that into a link for me. So if I hit enter, see the IPython there is in italics now. You can, with the notebook, also just have live websites. So I've written some code. Don't worry about this code. It's not part of the course. But look there, the source is this website. And I'm showing it how big frame to allow inside of this page. And it will actually render the live. This is the live website. And so you can even embed live websites. You can embed YouTube videos. There's all sorts of code that you can write in Python to do all of this for you. No matter, all I want you to do here is to visit that website. You can obviously learn a lot more about IPython. So let's just quickly rerun through the essentials. There's various ways to start IPython notebook. One way is to use the launcher, which installs with Anaconda for the Python version 3.4 and up on Windows and Mac. On Linux, though, you'll have to open a terminal window, but even in Windows, you can open a command prompt window, or Linux or Mac, open a terminal window, and you just type in IPython notebook, and you hit enter or return. It's going to open your default browser. In the folder that you are currently in when you ran this command in terminal window, whatever folder you are in on your computer's hard disk, it's going to open in that, in your default browser, as we saw before. So with these modern versions of Anaconda 3.4, you actually get this navigation. You do get this navigation that did not always exist, didn't exist before, but you can. So I showed you how to open the new notebook, and I also showed you the toolbar. If you were to click, look here, I've just imported an image which lives in this very same folder. So I can just refer to the file itself. in the same folder that this notebook is in. So this file is right in this folder. It doesn't show up because it's not a notebook. But because it lives in the same folder, I can just reference it. If it wasn't, I would have to put in C:// for Windows or wherever it was hidden. I had to write out the whole computer address for this. But because they're in the same folder, I can just do this. And there's a beautiful image. What I wanted to show you here is if you double click there, in other words, this is going to show up and you can rename or name your notebook there. That name will then be saved and it will update there. Okay, the cells we've spoken about, that is really the beauty of IPython. If I double click on there, there's that code, see all the P's, close P, open P, close P, open P, close P. So this is all going to be rendered as paragraphs. Between each of these P's and close P's, that will render as a paragraph, and then we'll start a new paragraph there. And remember the little star signs? Yes, those were just for italicizing. And you can see the cell is marked on italicizing that text. So if I run it 1, 2, 3 paragraphs, and we've got the italics there. NBConvert, we'll talk about that a little bit later. There is a way then in the terminal or command prompt window that you can use IPython space NBConvert and then the name of your file, and that will convert it to another format. So you can do HTML, you can do PDF, and we'll do a bit of that later on, and that's a beautiful way to save these notebooks in a different format than the IPYNB format. You can save it as HTML or PDF, as I mentioned, and you can share it with someone else. Let's start coding a bit. Now, usually with learning computer language, people start with a hello world example. I'd like to start with some mathematics though. Now, one of the basic building blocks of any computer language is the variable. Now, I use the term computer variable because I also do a lot of lectures in maths, and obviously a mathematical variable is something other than a computer variable. So what's a computer variable? Well, in essence, it is this space in a computer's memory. We can call it an empty bucket. And that variable name is the name we give to that bucket, and we can put various things into that bucket. So let's try this out live. So in this cell, all I've done is I've written a = 7. Just that little bit there, a = 7. A is my variable and its name. And so I've created the space in memory, this bucket. I've called it a and I've put a value into that 7. Now the 7 is an integer. Now look at something, you'll see this pound sign, hashtag sign, whatever you want to call it. Anything in a line after this little sign is ignored by Python. So it will not be executed. So if you want to leave some notes for yourself, like I've done here, a = 7, the value 7 is an integer. That just gets ignored. You see it's turned green here. And in a new line, I've started this new line, look there, with another hashtag sign. So this line of code will be ignored. But it's just that if you hand this over to someone else or you review your code later on and you've put these little reminders, these little comments, you've left them there, it'll help you out tremendously. So, unlike other computer languages, I don't have to tell Python what type of data I'm putting in here. This is an integer. It'll just infer from context. Now, let's just execute this. I'm going to hit Shift Enter, and nothing happens. Nothing happens. You see, this has jumped to number 3. I'm just executing that. Nothing has happened. It's just created this little space in the computer's RAM and the memory, called it A, that little space, and it's put a value in there. Very exciting indeed. Now let's heat things up. Let's go to this cell, and I'm going to say B = 4. Hit Shift Enter, Shift Return, or the play button. Or I've created another bucket. I've put another integer value into it. How do I get to what's in that though? I can just simply type A. So that would be one way. If I just type in A and I hit enter, lo and behold, the 7 appears. It remembers that 7 is that. So I'm just going to output that. So my input code there in the cell was A. I hit shift enter, shift return, and it did 7. Another way to do it is to use the print command. Print, and you're going to put these brackets. Now I want to warn you, there's a big difference between the Python versions 2, 2.7, 2.5, 2.6, 2.7, and the version 3.x, 3, 3.1, 3.2, 3.4, as this is. Big difference. With those, you just had, this print A like that. Okay, it's not going to work if you run older code. Okay, so this is for Python versions 3 and up. So if I say print A and I run this, lo and behold, we're also going to get the 7. Now let's do some math. What is 7 to the power 4? And this is the way you do powers in Python. It's this double star sign, not like in most computer languages where you use this caret. You're going to use the double equal sign. So I've written A. Now these spaces here, you needn't put spaces. Here we go. It's just that. And 2,401. Voila. Now we can do simple addition. What would be, remember I had 7 and 4. If I just typed in 7 plus A plus B, I run that. Obviously that's going to give me an 11. A minus B is going to be 3. A times B, that's just a one star sign, that's 28. A divided by B, 5.5. Now, oh, where did we go? A divided by B, 1.75. I'm just going to warn you as well, with the older versions, any number that you put in that's an integer is going to be seen purely as an integer. Actually, in Python version 3, all the version 3s, it actually sees these values as floats. And if you're using Python 2.7, for instance, you might get very strange things when you do division. So just watch out for that. This is the modulus sign. So if I divide 7 by 4, it goes into 4 goes into 7 once, and 3 is left. That 3 is the modulus. So that's what you're going to get there. Now you can also force the arithmetic operations, the order of that. So I want to add A plus B first and then divide it by 2. If I didn't use those, it was going to do, remember, B divided by 2 and then add that to A. So you can force it just by parentheses. And now for the reason why I call these things computer variables, because what's going to happen in this line of code? A equals A plus 5. That makes no algebraic sense, as you would well imagine, because if I brought A to the other side, it's going to say 0 equals 5. And that doesn't work. It's because these are not algebraic or mathematical variables. These are computer variables. So what does the computer say? It executes the right-hand side of this equation first. It says, what is an A at the moment? Well, there's 7 in there. I'm going to add 5 to that makes it 12, and I'm going to put that 12 into that bucket, which was called A. Okay, so that's what's going to do, and lo and behold, if I print that, it's now 12. A is now 12. Now for the real power of Python. The beauty and power of Python. We can extend the language by simply importing code someone else has developed for us. And the way to import this is just to use the import statement, import math. So math is this module. Sometimes we refer to these as libraries, modules. Someone who's intimately familiar with Python and computer language will obviously know what the differences are. For us, we can just call it whatever we want, import math. So let's run that code. So math is now part, it's extended, it's in its little mind, Python's mind, it's extended all the code you can use by importing this math module. Now I'm going to use the sine of pi. Now, I have to refer to this module or library first before I can use whatever's inside of it. So I have to say math.sine of math.pi. And that's not the way we're going to do it. I'm just showing you how to reference code that's inside of a library. So I have to use the library name and then whatever's inside of it. So this math.sign, the sign will be a method inside of the math module there. If I execute that, you're going to see something very funny. Now, remember, pi has got an infinite number of decimal places. It goes on forever. Your computer can't do that. It's going to truncate it somewhere. And then it's going to take the sign of that truncated value. And it can do quite a fair bit with that, because it's not an exact thing, that it doesn't go off to infinity. You are going to get this scientific notation, 1.2 times 10 to the power negative 16. While anything with 16 zeros after the decimal point, you can obviously see Python was trying to say that this is zero. The sine of pi, or the sine of 180 degrees, is zero. A better way to do, or another way to import modules, is to say from math, import then these methods that you want, cosine, pi. So it's only going to import those. Let's run that. The beauty of that, though, is now I don't have to refer to that module name. I don't have to say math.cosine, math.pi. I can just say the cosine of pi. So what's the cosine of 180 degrees? Obviously, it's negative 1. So that's one way, but you have to explicitly write all these functions or methods that you want to import. Another way to do it is to say import numpy. That's the same as we said there, import math, but give it an abbreviation. So import numpy. Numpy is this beautiful beautiful module that can do all sorts of numerical calculations. And I'm going to abbreviate it by this np. So if I run that, Python has extended itself, but it's imported this numpy module, but it's given it an abbreviation. So if I now want to refer to the cosine, which lives inside of Python, I can just say np.cosine. I don't have to write out numpy, as I had to write out math there. So I'm going to say np.cosine of the np.pi, and if I run that, lo and behold, that of course is also negative 1. Last thing we're going to look at quickly is using strings. A variable can also contain other things, not only integers or floating point values. Here I've just said a equals okay, hello world. Okay, here we go, hello world. And I've got to put it in these inverted commas. Now you can use double quotes or single quotes. It doesn't matter. I like single quotes. But if you want this to be a string, you've got to put it inside of these inverted commas. So let's just run that. If I now were to say A, type in A and run it, it's going to output that to the screen. Okay, here we go. Hello world. Another way to do it. But see these little quotation marks. They've added them, because that's the output. It's trying to, I suppose, for lack of a better explanation, trying to see it as a numerical value. It's just putting these. Pay no heed to what I've just said. Print A. If I do that, it's really just going to print out just the text. Okay, here we go. Hello world. I can attach something else to B now. This is Python, and run that. And I can now concatenate these two strings. I can say A plus. Now that's another string I'm putting in there, which is an empty space, plus B. I'm adding a space between these two strings because I'm using the plus concatenation. So if I were to run that, it's going to do them all in one go. Okay, hello world. Okay, here we go. Hello world, this is Python. So it's added those two together. I can use the print command and separate it with a comma. Then I don't need to add that space or anything funny like that. If I were to run this, it was going to concatenate them and put that little space in there. Okay, here we go. Hello world, this is Python. Now for surprise, what is A times 2? If I were to run that, lo and behold, here we go. Okay, here we go. Hello world. Okay, here we go. Hello world. So it's just going to output that twice. Let's put something else. Let's put something else into A. So I've got these three integer values, but I've enclosed them in the square bracket, and that is what is called an array of values. The first one is going to be called A0, that's going to be A1, and this is going to be A2. Python always starts counting things from zero. So if I now output it A to the screen, it's going to give me this whole thing. And if I were to multiply an array by 2, it's not going to multiply each individual entry by 2. That would be a matrix, that's something else. It's just going to repeat this array twice. 12 times 13 times 12, 13, 18. Sorry, 12, 13, 18. So it's just done it twice. I can do a lot more with an array. That's an integer. That's an integer. That's string, text. And that's just the computer variable B. So I can put all sorts of things in there. Now you see it's 2, 3, hello. And remember, B was this is Python. So it'll put this is Python there. So that's an array. And the very last thing, to some Boolean values. What are Boolean values? There's our first one, a double equal sign. And that is a question you ask the computer. Is whatever is in variable A equal to whatever is in variable B? it asks that question. So if I were to run that, it's going to say false. Because remember, A was, okay, here we go, hello world, and B was, this is Python. And those two strings are definitely not the same. This is the question mark, the Boolean question mark, or question, I should say, is not equal to. So it's an exclamation mark equal. So I'm asking, is whatever's in A not equal to what is in B? And definitely that is so. So those, whatever's inside of variable A and variable B are not the same, so this will execute as true. So let's just check that out one more time. A equals I love math is a string. A equals equals I love math. So I'm asking it, is that what is inside of A at the moment? Yes, it is. True. So that's your very quick introduction to a bit of coding. More importantly, the introduction to the IPython notebook. I think you can be familiar now with how these cells work. And I've introduced just the tiniest bit of code. Nothing too difficult. Watch this lecture again. Work your way through this. Don't be scared to alter things, mess them about. You've got to play with this to understand how it works. This is all easy, but the things that I've shown you here, we are going to use in future for this lecture series. And as you start manipulating your own data, these are the common things that we're going to use over and over again. It really doesn't get much more difficult than this. Easy introduction to coding. I hope you enjoyed it.